Good evening, and welcome to Wilson Hall. Please take a moment to locate your nearest emergency exit, and at this time, please stop texting and turn off your cell phone. There will be no intermission. Thank you, and enjoy the presentation.
Good evening, everybody. I'm John Alger, president of James Madison University, and it's my honor to welcome you all tonight to our Madison Vision Series conversation, which also celebrates Constitution Day here at James Madison University. This series, the Madison Vision Series, was created to honor James Madison's conviction that cultivating an informed and educated citizenry is essential to the health of our Republican democracy. This series brings scholars, thinkers, and leaders of all kinds together for a lively exploration of issues facing our society. To mark this occasion, we are honored to welcome a very special guest who has recently joined or rejoined JMU's Board of Visitors, Carly Fiorina. Her life story is a shining example of the American dream in action. Carly began her career as a secretary for a 9-person real estate firm. She climbed the corporate ladder at AT&T and Lucent Technologies, where she was then recruited to Hewlett-Packard with a mission to transform the company from a laggard to a leader, becoming the first woman to lead a Fortune 50 company. During her tenure as chair and CEO, Hewlett-Packard became the largest technology company in the world. Both government and the private sector have sought out Carly's vast problem-solving, team-building, and leadership experience. At the federal level, she's advised the CIA and the Departments of Defense, State, and Homeland Security. She founded Carly Fiorina Enterprises to bring her expertise to private sector teams and the Unlocking Potential Foundation to allow those in the social sector to benefit from her experience. She's the author of three best-selling books on leadership for general audiences, as well as a weekly LinkedIn newsletter with over 500,000 subscribers. She's a frequent speaker to teams and executives of many industries all over the world. But Carly also believes that citizens and leaders in civil society have an important role and an enormous opportunity to drive positive change. In 2015, Carly launched a campaign for President of the United States. Americans came to know Carly as a clear-eyed, direct leader capable of actually solving problems and delivering results. She is also a member of the newly formed American Bar Association Task Force for American Democracy, which is focused on those actions necessary to improve citizens' confidence in American elections. And she serves as the founding visionary and executive chair of the Williamsburg Institute, as chair of the Board of Trustees of the Colonial Williamsburg Foundation, and national honorary chair of the Virginia 250 Commission. In these roles, she's focused on ensuring that our nation's founding is broadly understood, accurately portrayed, and commemorated in an inclusive, accessible way, particularly as we approach the United States' semi-quincentennial. Now that's a mouthful, but I got from Carly that is the right term, the semi-quincentennial in 2026. Carly also has deep personal ties to JMU. She's had 2 granddaughters attend JMU, Kara, who graduated recently from the College of Education, and Morgan, who's with us tonight, is a current student in the College of Business. So the family is all in. Carly has also been a great friend and encouraged many of us here in leadership. She's not only brilliant, but kind and compassionate also, a truly rare combination. Carly's going to start us off now with a talk titled, To Create a More Perfect Union. After her initial remarks, I will join her for a brief Q&A session, and then I'm going to bring up one of our students who will join us on stage as well, and we hope to have time for questions from all of you as well. So now, please join me in welcoming Carly Fiorina.
Well, thank you so much. It's an honor and privilege to be here with you to celebrate Constitution Day. And in addition to our wonderful, beautiful, talented granddaughter Morgan, who's with us here tonight in the front row, we also have our daughter Tracy, our son-in-law Lowell, and my husband Frank. So we are indeed a proud Duke's family. As you heard, I started out in an unusual way, perhaps. I graduated with a degree in history, medieval history to be exact, and philosophy. And when I graduated, it was a time of gas shortages, a recession, and national malaise. I tried law school, dropped out after less than a semester, and ran away to Italy to teach English. You can imagine the concern of my parents. As John said, my first full-time job was as a receptionist, answering the phone at a 9-person real estate firm. It was the definition of a dead-end job. However, the two founders of this little company, which eventually would become a huge company, Marcus and Millichap, saw something in me and encouraged me to learn more about the world of business. And to this day, I have never forgotten what it felt like to have someone see more potential than others might realize, or that I myself thought was possible. Eventually, I would earn an MBA. I was hired in downtown Washington, D.C., where I met my husband, Frank, as an entry-level employee into a massive company, 1 million employees, called the Bell System. I was a nobody at the very bottom of a very long, very intimidating corporate ladder. In this first job, I was introduced by my boss as, "This is Carly, our token bimbo." And I experienced my first business meeting with clients in a downtown strip club, because that's where they wanted to eat lunch. It was a different time. I was not trying to get promoted. I was just trying to keep my job. And I thought that I needed to make a difference to earn my paycheck. Everywhere I went, I saw unsolved problems and people who were impacted by them. I collaborated with those people to solve those problems, not because someone told us to do so, but because we thought we could and should do so. The results we produced together had an impact and got noticed. And as the years went by, I gained the experience, skill, confidence, and credibility to focus on bigger, more complex, and more far-reaching problems. From my first job until now, here are the things that I've learned. Problems abound. They fester not because people are unaware of them, but because people are not prepared to do what is necessary to solve them. Solving problems means things have to change. The status quo, the way things are, is powerful in every setting, even when that status quo is glaringly and obviously deficient. Challenging the status quo means overcoming fear for many people, enduring criticism, facing resistance, experiencing setback, and causing lots of people to be uncomfortable. Sometimes, a lot of times, it's just easier to complain about a problem, or tweet about a problem, or make speeches about a problem, or blame others for a problem, than it is to do the hard work of solving a problem. Problem solving is hands-on, really hard work. It begins not with a big abstract problem like world hunger, but with a close-in on-the-ground problem like hunger in my neighborhood. Or to use an example closer to home, solving the problem of uncivil discourse means learning how to speak respectfully to someone with whom you passionately disagree right here on campus. People closest to the problem usually know best how to solve it. if only we will ask. Sadly, we so often don't ask. We don't ask because we don't like them or don't agree with them, or because their circumstances or their appearance cause us to dismiss them. We don't ask because we convince ourselves that because of our titles or our positions or our opinions or our circumstances, that we are somehow smarter than they are. Problem solvers look for progress, not perfection. Problem solvers realize that once progress begins, other problem solvers will come along to continue that progress. Management and leadership are different. Managers do the best they can with the way things are. There's nothing wrong with management, and it's important. Leaders, however, change the way things are. They challenge the status quo. They enlist and unlock the potential in others. They solve the on-the-ground problems that are right in front of them, and they begin the process of progress. Finally, everyone has more potential for leadership than we or they themselves realize. Each of us collaborating with others can make an impact and solve a problem that's right in front of us. Leadership is not about title, position, wealth, or fame. It is about changing the order of things for the better. Like all of us, my perspectives have been shaped by all these experiences. I believe the Constitution is both a document that arose from a very real set of problems, as well as a framework for ensuring that progress continues to be made to solve current and future problems. Although the script and the language of the Constitution are different and more formal than our own, the Constitution is not a dusty relic of the past. Rather, it is a practical guide as well as an inspiration. We are here in Virginia, and Virginia has always been the crucible of our nation. From the very beginning, Virginia was the richest of the 13 colonies, representing 40% of the economic output of all the colonies before the Revolution and the Constitution. The fiercest debates, including give me liberty or give me death, happened here in Virginia. Incitement to revolution occurred first in Virginia when gunpowder stores were seized by the Crown and the First Revolutionary Army was mustered in Virginia. Here, from slave rebellions to abolition movements, right through from the Civil War to civil rights, from the imprisonment and force feeding of women in a prison in Virginia who were fighting for the right to vote, Virginia has always been a crucible for great ideas, great debates, as well as great conflicts, for innovation and injustice, for tragedy as well as triumph, for hostility and for reconciliation. And every founding document upon which our nation has been built, the Bill of Rights, the Declaration of Independence, and the Constitution, was written by a Virginian. Most Americans, perhaps actually most of you, don't share my love of history. Many Americans think it just doesn't matter and is boring besides. Many have become cynical about it, believing that history is told in different ways by different political factions for different political purposes. Some believe history is cherry-picked for the heroes. Others believe history overemphasizes the horrors. Many feel their stories are untold, but most are simply unaware. All this cynicism and indifference, resentment and ignorance about our history is a great loss. We know it is a loss because each of us as human beings long to know what came before us, who came before us. It's why families sit around and talk about their past. It's why genealogy sites or apps like 23andMe are so popular, because they speak to the deep, intuitive longing by all of us to understand who we are by learning about who and what came before us. We cannot fully understand the present or ourselves in it, and therefore cannot effectively face the future unless we understand our past. It is true of families, it is true of communities, it is true of nations. History, when told completely and fully, is a mirror into which we look to see ourselves more clearly. History is a conversation with the present and an indispensable guide to the future. A noted Virginia historian, Edward Ayers, has this to say: nostalgia for the past and a love of history are not the same thing. Nostalgia dims and diminishes the past by softening its contours. History honors the past by taking its struggles seriously. I spent the afternoon in a business class, so allow me to describe the early beginnings of our nation in business case terms. Concerned by the economic success of the Spaniards in exploiting the New World to the south, what we would call Latin America today, and the incursions of the French to the north, today's Canada, the English monarchy decided it was time to catch up. The crown granted to the Virginia Company a charter to explore the New World. And so, 104 English men and boys arrived on 3 sailing ships and established Jamestown. If you thought that Plymouth Rock was where colonialists first landed, you would be wrong. It was in Jamestown in 1607. Imagine this: by 1608 and 9, only one of those 104 English men and boys was still alive. Dissension, disease, and death had decimated the settlement. Faced with abysmal failure, the Virginia Company asked for a new charter. They realized that the people actually living in Jamestown would be in a better position to choose the best course of action than people who sat an ocean and a world away. The company's goal with this new charter was to establish local lines of authority and local decision-making. The charter, granted in 1609, called for a sole governor who would reside in Jamestown. That sole governor would arrive the next year, and he decided everything about daily life, from how often settlers attended worship service, twice a day required, to punishment for transgressions of all kinds. The governor's code was known as laws divine, mortal, and martial. His power was absolute. His authority was unquestioned. Several years later, tobacco was introduced to Jamestown, and this cash crop became profitable. But nevertheless, Jamestown continued to disappoint its investors. Disease, malnutrition, and death remained ever present. Potential colonists and investors were attracted by other places, like the West Indies and Bermuda. The promise of a harsh life governed by the harsh laws of a near dictator wasn't very appealing. And so, to compete and succeed, Jamestown needed an overhaul. In 1618, the then CEO of the Virginia Company created what is known as the Great Charter. This new charter dramatically reduced the power of the governor and created the General Assembly, whose members, the burgesses, would be elected by the people, represent the people, and make decisions and enact laws on their behalf. It was a dramatic innovation. It was the first representative government ever. The Great Charter also introduced property ownership, another first. It didn't matter who you were anymore, or what your last name was, or who you knew. To spur growth, any investor who came to Jamestown, any investor would be awarded 100 acres of land. Adventurers who paid their own passage to Jamestown were to be granted 50 acres, with another 50 acres awarded for every additional person they brought along. This also was a first. 1619 was a momentous year. Both the political and economic reforms of the Great Charter were implemented. The General Assembly held its first meeting. For the first time anywhere, property ownership could be purchased, earned. The first women settlers arrived. Now men were no longer working just for wages from the Virginia Company. Now men and women were working for themselves, their families, their futures. And so began democracy and entrepreneurship. foundations upon which the strength and wealth of our nation has been built. Economic necessity forced political and economic freedoms. To achieve economic gain, power had to be relinquished, and risks had to be taken. And in 1619, the first enslaved Africans arrived, bound in chains for the entirety of their journey across an ocean in the literal hellhole of the slave ship. While we know from contemporaneous accounts that many residents of Jamestown were shocked and horrified by the unspeakably cruel treatment endured by these new arrivals, we also know investors recognized that this new source of labor could ensure manpower for the increasingly lucrative but labor-intensive tobacco crops. So began the normalization of the idea that some are more human than others and the institutionalization of human slavery. And this shame of our nation also built a great deal of the wealth of our nation and entwined itself in our social fabric. I was a philosophy major, you will recall, so I remember reading Plato, the great Greek philosopher, for the first time. Plato observed that ideals and principles may feel abstract because we cannot touch them or talk to them or observe them. Against the bright colors, the loud noises, and all the distractions of the real world, ideas and principles may seem as faint and silent as flickering shadows cast by firelight in a cave. This was his analogy. And yet, Plato said, ideals and principles are real and powerful. They can drive change. When insight into what feeds the human spirit and experience about what works in the real world are combined with principles and ideals, then the world can change. This interplay between practicality and idealism is America's story and our gift to the world. What practical, real-world fundamentals can we distill from the early business case of the first settlers in Jamestown? I think there are four, which we and the revolutionary Americans and all of us know to be true. People closest to the problem know best how to solve it. Decision-making far away in England didn't work. The Declaration of Independence in 1776 was about putting decision-making where it belonged. It was a huge risk, a bet-the-farm move, and failure lurked around every corner. This bet could only be made because of the economic wealth and economic power that had been created, not just through the vast natural resources of the New World, but the labors of everyone here. Indentured, enslaved, and free. What else did we learn from Jamestown? That power concentrated is power abused and potential squandered. The revolutionary movement was born from the recognition that too much power concentrated in the hands of an English monarch and an English parliament was abusive and holding the 13 colonies back. The Constitution was written not only to enumerate rights, but also to constrain and divide power in the new American government. In fact, our founders were obsessed with the idea of power and how to constrain it. Sometimes we try to convince ourselves that if power is only concentrated in good hands or the right hands, that it will not be abused and the best outcomes will be achieved. Both business experience and political history teach us otherwise. Pure motives, good intentions, and even promising beginnings cannot change the reality that a group of few people is never smart enough or capable enough to make all the myriad of right decisions on behalf of the many. And the exercise of concentrated power becomes an end in and of itself. It is why so often the driving purpose of the powerful becomes self-preservation. Eventually, when the many have grown frustrated enough, they check out, move on, or rebel. Third, people will never achieve their full potential and perform at their best unless they are working for their own benefit, not simply someone else's. Ambition, energy, creativity, and hard work are in direct proportion to how much stake someone has in the outcome of their own efforts. If my efforts cannot impact my future, then why work hard? If I have no stake in my future, why build it? The corollary is what we learned when land was granted to anyone who paid their passage to America. It is hard to predict someone else's success. People have more potential than we can see by looking at them or their current circumstances. Someone needs to take a chance on all of us. And when people apply their best efforts because they are motivated by their own future, we all benefit and greater growth is achieved. In the right circumstances, people can amaze and surprise you with their capacity. The best leaders are those who know success is achieved by unlocking potential in others. This is a leader's highest calling. Finally, we learn that our own fears can blind us to the suffering of others and cause us to ignore both our principles and what we know to be true. We are all human and flawed, and change is always hard. Our fear of loss, of power, wealth, status, or way of life can cause us to demonize or dehumanize someone else. This is not a justification, but it is a fact of human nature. Our Constitution and Bill of Rights recognized the importance of local decision making and hence enshrined states' rights and gave great powers to local governments. The federal government was given important, enumerated, but limited powers. Three branches of government were designed in our Constitution to achieve checks on that power and balance between centers of power. Every state constitution follows the same model of dividing and restraining power. And perhaps the greatest innovation of all is that in this country, in our Constitution, it is the citizen who is sovereign, not the president, not the political party, not the governor. The citizen is sovereign. Inspired by their own experiences of building a life and a future for themselves and lifted up by philosophers Locke, Hobbes, Rousseau, Montesquieu, and others, immortal words were written by George Mason, Thomas Jefferson, and James Madison, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. They formed a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. It is indisputably true that our founders believed the rights they espoused applied only to white male property owners. They did not consider the ownership of other human beings to be a vile abuse of power. Nevertheless, their words took deep thought and great courage to write, and their later ratification would take the same. These ideas were a radical departure from the past. They were radical also because they changed the world literally, then and into the present day. The words that were written and the system of government that was designed have inspired every movement for human dignity, sovereignty, equality, and liberty everywhere ever since. All of these great movements in our own country and in others, then and now, have looked to our history, our documents, for inspiration, justification, and motivation. We know most Americans are concerned about our current division and discord. We know this has seeped into the workplace and onto college campuses and made civil discourse, freedom of expression, and collaboration more difficult. You will often hear people say, "We have never been this divided." The truth is, we have always been a fractious country. From the very beginning, our diversity has been a source of strength, but it has also been a source of disagreement. We were divided at the time of the Revolution over religion, politics, economics, ethnicity, status, and class, divided over the issue of slavery, and we were even divided about whether the fight for independence was heroic and wise or treasonous and foolhardy. great movements forward in this country, beginning with the revolutionary movement, did not occur because everyone agreed with each other. They didn't occur because everyone liked each other. They didn't occur because everyone was treated equally. Like problem solving anywhere, anytime, progress is made only when enough individuals decide their common purpose is more important than individual differences, disagreements, or grievances. Alex de Tocqueville, writing in the mid-19th century, one of many Frenchmen enamored with the idea of America, wrote extensively about the great American experiment. He said, "The greatness of America lies not in being more enlightened than any other nation, but rather in her ability to repair her faults." In other words, our system is built to allow us to solve our problems. He went on to remark that our greatest strength lies not in our government or our politicians, but within our civil society, in families and communities, in academia and in business. Our greatest strength lies in our sovereign American citizens who gather together to build something better. And it is the framework of the Constitution that enables the innovation and the collaboration necessary to solve problems. Lasting change doesn't happen all at once. Positive change always happens from the ground up, driven by people trying to change the order of things for the better. Smaller, incremental experiences are important preparation for the groundbreaking declarations and breakthroughs. Setback and failure can be as clarifying and important as progress and success. Leaders are not always those with enormous power or lofty positions. Leaders are those who change the order of things for the better wherever they are. And thus, leaders come in all sizes, shapes, colors, and kinds, and from many different circumstances. Because of our Constitution, here in this country, more things have been more possible for more people of all kinds from more places than anywhere else on earth. This is not nostalgia. These are the facts of our history. Our economy, powered by the idea that anyone can have a stake in the future by taking a risk and making an investment, protected intellectual property and property in general, protected by the framework of the Constitution. Our economy has driven the economy of the world. Our economy has lifted billions out of poverty around the world. Our framework of limited, balanced government and the rule of law and the sovereignty of citizens has inspired the world. This is the only country in the world and in all of human history, for all our faults, this is the only country founded not on ethnicity or territory or religion, but instead on a unique combination of practical experience and inspiring ideas. So to everyone in the JMU community, I close by saying, being the change is not just a slogan. Being the change matters. Becoming fully prepared to be educated and enlightened citizens matters, and it is a noble and necessary mission. To form a more perfect union is not a task that falls to someone else. As with the Americans that came before us and those that will follow, the work to create a more perfect union is our privilege and our responsibility as American citizens. Thank you so very much.
Can you hear? Ah, there we go. All right. Well, we're now going to some questions, and I have the privilege of getting us started. So, Carly, you talked about that more perfect union and, you know, essentially our nation being a work in progress, right? A lot of people talk about the deep political polarization right now, and they feel sort of hopeless and helpless. To me, I heard optimism in your talk. Can you say a word about the state of affairs now? Do you have optimism about solving those big 21st century problems given our current state of affairs?
So first, let's acknowledge it's hard to look at our politics and feel optimistic, right? It's vitriolic, it's nasty. It seems like we are still talking about the same problems over and over and over and over every election cycle. And so when I look at our politics, I can become dismayed as well. But this country was never designed or intended to be all about the politicians. In fact, it was George Washington who said in his farewell address to the nation, "The trouble with political parties is they will come to care only about winning. And winning is not the same as problem solving." So I understand why people get concerned about the state of our politics. But I also know how much potential, creativity, thoughtful people are out there. How many are out there? I know how much potential exists on this university campus and the students and the professors who work here. I know how much potential exists in communities, even those that are marginalized and forgotten, because I work in them. And so I think as long as we will accept that as citizens we can do something about the problem that's right in front of us, we will. I fear that our greatest hurdle to get over is not an inability to solve problems. Our greatest hurdle is our passivity, our belief that somehow we can hand the job of citizenship and problem solving and innovation and changing things for the better to somebody else. We don't need to hand it off. We shouldn't hand it off, but we are very capable of changing the order of things for the better wherever we are.
And I love the fact you talked about the potential that every person has, but if they're given the ability to unlock that potential and through education, right? So I have to ask you about liberal arts. You know, that's one of my passions. I studied political science and history, and you obviously did not start down a path that would suggest this person is going to become the CEO of the largest high-tech company in the world. Can you talk about, especially for our students, thinking about the importance of a liberal arts, well-rounded education, and how did that help you in your career? Because you've done so many different things in different industries and sectors.
Look, not everybody has to be a history or a philosophy major, but what serves everyone well is the ability to think critically, the ability to communicate persuasively, the ability to collaborate effectively. Critical thinking, communication, collaboration, these are things that one learns in the liberal arts. You can learn them other places as well, but critical thinking, I think, is very important and a very important takeaway from a liberal arts education. There's one other thing that I would say. When you're problem solving, I said it in my prepared remarks, but problem solving is hard work. It takes time. It's on the ground. It's not up here. It's not abstract. It's not a perfectly curated Instagram photo or a clever tweet. It's hard work. And I think to do that hard work, perspective matters. And so one of the things that art or music or history or philosophy give you is perspective. Perspective about the human condition. Perspective about human nature. And that perspective is invaluable when you get down to actually doing the hard work of making something better.
So, speaking of perspective, you gave us a bit of a history lesson tonight, which is really valuable for a lot of Americans who don't know that history. And when you think about civics education in this country, it's obviously been declining in recent years. We had a nation's report card just recently on eighth grade civics that was really shocking, showing the decline in basic knowledge of civics. So what's at stake and how can we fix this problem?
So let me put an even finer point on your question. When immigrants come to this country today and become citizens, and immigration and entrepreneurship have fueled our economy since Jamestown, when immigrants come to this country and take the citizenship test, 80-something, I may not get the exact number right, but it's over 80% of American citizens could not pass that test. So think about that. Think about that. Why have we become so passive in the face of politicians who fail to deliver? And I think people on all sides of the aisle can agree that politicians frequently fail to deliver. Why have we become so passive? Because we don't actually understand what they're there to do. How can you hold someone accountable when you don't know what their role is? How can you demand better when you don't know what your role as sovereign citizen is? And so when we decry the state of our country and say it's the politician's fault, the truth is, as I said, the Constitution makes a citizen the sovereign. The citizen is the center of all the governance. They represent us. Unless we understand that, how can we play our rightful role? And how can we hold them accountable to theirs?
You know, and it's an interesting point. When we think about the founding period, a lot of those early leaders actually had other jobs, right? They were farmers.
They all had other jobs.
Right. And you have worked in business, but also the nonprofit sector. How can we learn from each other? Are there lessons to be learned from your business career, for example, that we ought to be thinking about in public policy and in government?
Yes. Well, first let me say, here in the Commonwealth of Virginia, you know, our government is, our elected delegates and senators are very proud of the fact that they're part-time. Mm-hmm. In New Hampshire, they're part-time as well. In other words, people are proud of the fact, I have a day job. Yeah. You know, I'm here representing, but that's not the only thing I do, as it has become in Washington. What could politics, what could government learn from business? Well, here are a couple things, and I am the first to say that policymaking in government is different than business. However, problem solving is the same. Problem solving is the same. I know that because I've done it in business. I've done it in support of government. I've done it in the social sector. Problem solving is always the same. Why? Because human beings are the same everywhere. The context is different. Maybe the rules are different. But problem solving is the same. And what problem solving always requires is the ability to find a goal that everyone can agree on and then work together to achieve the goal. So basic. Of course, it's a bit more complex than that, but it starts with that fundamental. So another thing that politics could learn from business is metrics, results, and accountability. You know, in business we measure things. We think producing results is important. We hold people accountable for results. Wouldn't that be great if we actually knew the results of government, that we could hold people accountable for achieving results and that there would be consequences?
Right. A good reminder certainly for all of us, right? We talk about this in education as well, that the need, and we are doing a much better job, I think, now of looking at results, right, with student learning outcomes, for example. I want to sneak in one more question before we call in our student, and that is about Virginia 250. Can you say a little bit more about that effort? You talked about that mirror that history can be for us. What kind of opportunity does this represent? It's only a few years away now, so what can we...
So in 2026, the nation will celebrate its 250th anniversary of our founding, the signing of the Declaration of Independence. we will have just come through a bruising presidential election campaign, no matter what the outcome is. I fully expect that during that presidential campaign, bad actors, China for sure, Russia probably, others, will be using technology, including artificial intelligence, to lay out a dark and alternative narrative about our country. It's already started. And so when our 250th commemoration comes around, I honestly, truly believe we face a fork in the road. Are we going to commemorate our nation in all its complexity and fullness, the heroes and the horrors? Are we going to celebrate our 250th in a way that unifies us and re-inspires us? Or are we going to continue to move in a more divided direction? I think that's an important fork. Virginia, as I tried to convey, is at the very center of the American story. Virginia's history is the American story. And so the Virginia 250 is already playing a leadership role in the nation. We have gathered all of the planning commissions from all across the country already. And here in the Commonwealth, there are a number of opportunities. We are going to have commemorative events over the next 2.5 years in every community in Virginia, because being Virginia, every community has a story to tell about our founding. We are going to have 9 national signature events. We've already begun them, 3 a year, beginning with March of this year, 24, 25, 26, where the eyes of the nation will be on the Commonwealth of Virginia and what happened here to form and forge this nation. Yes, Philadelphia and Boston are going to have their celebrations. We don't begrudge them that, but Virginia's history is America's story. And so the opportunities are rich. Opportunities to get engaged in your community with the commemoration. Opportunities for universities to collaborate together to uncover and reveal more history. Opportunities to fund some of these wonderful events. As citizens, we all have an opportunity to get engaged, and I hope we will.
That's very exciting. So circle 2026 on your calendars.
It's circling it now, because absolutely. We have, for example, later this year, earlier this year, I should say, we revealed the complex and previously untold story of the very first school for the education of enslaved black children, the very first church where enslaved African Americans worshiped, and we will be celebrating the completion of that restoration next year, and have worked very hard with the descendant community.
That's great, great work. Well, at this point, I do want to call up one of our students, Emma Nyland, to the stage. And Emma is a senior political science major and Spanish minor here at JMU. This fall, she joined the Madison Center for Civic Engagement as a Democracy Fellow and a project lead for Duke's Vote podcast. She's recently had the opportunity to demonstrate her passions for public service through internships on Capitol Hill and in policy think tanks. Emma also recently founded the JMU chapter, and this is really cool, of the Alexander Hamilton Society. We can show him some love too, right along with James Madison. It's a nonpartisan national organization that focuses on educating university students on strong U.S. global leadership through moderated discussion, debates, and lectures with expert speakers in the field. So, Emma, welcome, and I know you have a question or two for Carly.
I do. President Alger and Mrs. Fiorina, it is truly an honor and a privilege to be up with the two of you tonight and engage in conversation. Before I get started, Mrs. Fiorina, I just have to share that you actually served as the original inspiration for my passion for civic engagement and a career in public policy. As an eighth grade young woman sitting in her eighth grade civics class, I saw you running for president, and in that exact moment, I still remember realizing I could break through glass ceilings too. So thank you for serving as inspiration for not only me, but other young women everywhere. Thank you very much for that. And that anecdote actually ties into my first question to you, which connects to your trailblazing career, in historically male-dominated fields. So what advice do you have for women who are interested in pursuing a career in leadership as the first woman to lead a Fortune 50 company and as a trailblazer in the political field?
So I'll begin by saying that while the world has changed since I was coming up, it hasn't changed as much as we might have hoped. If you looked at the Fortune 500 today, just as an example, there are more CEOs named James or John than there are women. And it's not because women aren't qualified or prepared. It's because change is hard. When you're different, it's different. When you're different by virtue of where you come from or how you talk or the color of your skin or your gender, when you're different from everyone else, it's different. When I say it's different, I mean the expectations are different, the scrutiny is different, the criticism is different. It's just different. What I learned early on is that what can help everyone get over the fact that it's different is to produce results, to solve problems, to work with whomever is willing to work with you and get something done. I had a subordinate early on in my career. I was a boss for the first time. And this gentleman, I sat down to talk with him for the first time. And he looked at me and he said, I've never worked for a woman. I don't want to work for a woman. I don't like working for a woman. He was really unhappy. And I said, thank you for telling me. And I meant it, because I'd rather know. And then I said, okay, tell me, is there something in your work that's a problem for you? Is there something that I could help you make better? And he thought about that for a while, and he said, well, yeah, there's this. And I said, okay, well, how about you and I work together on making that better? And we did. And about 3 months later, he came and said, you know, you're the best boss I've ever worked for. What I've learned over and over again is if you let other people's expectations of you define you, then they're your problem. If someone else thinks less of you because you're different, then it's their problem until you start to believe it. So, know who you are, know what you're capable of, not in an arrogant way, but in a confident way, but balance that confidence with the humility to understand that you always need help, we all do, and that ultimately, if you want to lead, you got to make things better, not just for yourself, but for others. And what I learned over and over again is if you produce the results, if you change things for the better, people will notice.
Thank you for that. I also think that testimony is super relevant, you know, in such a highly scrutinized world with social media, just really producing results. So my second and final question for you is going to be that as a democracy fellow with the Madison Center for Civic Engagement, I have seen this incredible movement on campus towards civic engagement and a constructive dialogue towards nonpartisanship leadership. And so for any JMU students or students at other universities who are interested in pursuing a career in public service or civil discourse, what advice can you give to them, you know, with them trying to pursue these fields while also keeping in mind at the forefront of everything they do, the common good?
So first, I applaud. I greatly applaud, as I've told John and his team, I greatly applaud the Center for Civic Engagement, the collaboration around freedom of expression that JMU is leading among other universities. I think it's incredibly important. And I think it's incredible, it will be, is being very effective because it's not just talk. The effort is focused on actually tools to help people learn how to engage in civil discourse. It's hard, let's face it. It's hard to try and collaborate with someone with whom you think, oh my gosh, we have nothing in common. I disagree with everything you say. It's hard. And so teaching people, giving people tools for effective collaboration with someone who is very different than they are, that's incredibly important. Secondly, the effort is focused on measuring things. Metrics matter. Because if we measure something, it means we really care about it. And if we measure something, then we know whether or not we're making progress. And if we measure something, we can hold ourselves accountable to achieving something. And so I think measuring is this effective or not is extremely important. I want to just comment on your point about social media. I do worry that, you know, social media is, it shortens our attention span. It heightens our sensitivity to being offended all the time. People will say things on social media that they would never say to somebody's face. It is exactly the opposite of problem solving and the production of results, because on social media you can make it look like what you want it to be, which is not the same as actually changing something so that it is what you hope it could be. So what I would say to anyone who wants to practice this or have a profession in this is start where you are. Practice with the people who are in your community right now. It's not a big abstract thing, civil discourse. It is, let me have a conversation and try to learn from someone who's very different than me, with whom I think I don't agree on very much, but let's see if we can find a larger goal, a bigger purpose that we actually agree on. People usually know what the problem is. They just don't really want to do what's necessary to solve the problem. And doing what's necessary to solve the problem starts with collaborating with a lot of people, most of whom are not like you, and many of whom won't agree with you on everything.
Thank you for that. Your insight's very applicable to actually the common goal of the Madison Center for Civic Engagement, and that has been very helpful. So thank you so much for your insightful answers to my questions, and thank you again for serving as an inspiration and role model for so many people around our country.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Emma. So now, it's your turn. I think we have, a couple of microphones, David, is that right? That will be, we have a couple people with microphones, so if you have a question, if you would raise your hand, and the microphones will find you. So it's a little hard to see from up here, David, with the bright lights, so we're counting on you to find folks. It looks like we've got a question there in the second row.
Hello, Ms. Fiorina. I would like to
Hi again.
I would like to thank you so much for your time and being able to answer the student body's questions as well. My question for you is drawing inspiration internationally from other state actors such as Germany. Germany has a 13-party system, and many other countries have many other parties as well. Obviously, our country is focused on our two-party system. My question for you is, through education of third parties, maybe emphasizing third party in academia, along with emphasizing third party candidates and such in businesses and everything, do you believe that third parties have the power to be able to facilitate working across party lines? Or do you believe or have hope that our two-party system will one day produce results and be able to properly represent the sovereignty of the people?
Well, there's a softball question. So let me start by saying that our founding fathers, since we've been talking about history here, our founding fathers did not want political parties. They urged against political parties. And they urged against political parties because they feared that political parties would become centers of power in their own right. And they turned out to be correct. Political powers are centers of power in their own right. I think it's fair to say that many, many Americans believe the two-party system is not serving us well. And what I learned running for president that I really didn't understand as a citizen is that in the two-party system, the primary voter has all the power, not the general election voter. I mean, we all think it's about the general election, right? But it turns out it is the primary voters who have the power because they select the nominee. And primary voters on both sides tend to be more extreme than general election voters. But they're the ones that knock on the doors and raise the money, and so they have the power. And so what's happened is, and then of course, as George Washington told us, the trouble with political parties is they will come to care only about winning. So when you care about winning, what do? You gerrymander districts, you make sure that people spend most of their time not solving problems, but actually raising problems and saying it's their fault, it's their fault, it's their fault. So I think it's fair to say the two-party system isn't serving us well, and if you doubt that, then again, think about the problems we talk about every election. How long have we been talking about immigration? 40 years? How long have we been talking about education? How long have we been talking about out-of-control spending? Name your problem. We've been talking about it forever. Because in some cases, the honest, bitter truth is it's not in a politician's interest to solve a problem. It's in the politician's interest to raise money off a problem and win with a problem. That's just the hard truth. It's not that all politicians are bad, not at all. I believe we have two very hardworking senators in the Commonwealth of Virginia, for example. I don't agree with them on everything, but I think they are trying to serve us very well. But if this were a business case, what would you say? A duopoly is no longer meeting the needs of the customer, so what would the business solution be? Competition. Right? A third party. And there have been nibbles around the edges around a third party. And I think theoretically it could well be helpful. I think no one has yet figured out, doesn't mean it can't be figured out, maybe it's a project for your students, you and your colleagues. No one has figured out how that would work in our system, which is built on an electoral college. In other words, the parties in Germany, all those different parties, generally their elections are won by popular vote. That's not the way our federal elections work. And so no labels, you've heard of no labels, they're talking about doing something this election. The problem is, if you do the math, it's really hard to see how they can succeed with the Electoral College. So that's a problem that's yet to be solved. But ultimately, these two parties will become more responsive and accountable, or something's going to give.
Thank you, Carly. Do we have other questions? I see a hand over here, David, it looked like.
Yeah. Oh. Hi there. Hi, Mrs. Fiorina. It's me again from the business class. You touched a lot about the polarization and division and disassociation that's happening to the citizens of this country. I want to speak that question to more to the context of college campuses, specifically our campus. And I say that I want to commemorate the people I'm sitting next to. These are all students, over a dozen, that go out of their time, go out of their day and take time out of their day to fight this fight and acknowledge this problem and make it better every day on this campus. So I want to take time that I appreciate that as a student here at James Madison University. But what steps do you think we should take as students together next to help solve these? Like you said, it's a project. Help solve this project together. What do you think?
So, in my experience, the best way to get people to work together, and working together helps people understand each other better, the best way to get people to work together is to focus them on a problem that they all think needs solved. Problems are opportunities. Find a problem. Find a problem that matters to the students on this campus, that everyone agrees is a problem, and gather a diverse group of students with very diverse opinions and sit in a room and work on how might we solve this problem. Here's the other truth. You know, when everybody agrees with each other, why do you suppose, let me use an analogy, you know, you can think about companies, boardrooms, where a group of really intelligent, high-powered people just drive themselves right off a cliff and make a decision that you're like, how could this possibly have happened? You know, how could, I'll use a relatively current example, how could all these people, smart, sophisticated people, think that Sam Bankman-Fried was anything other than a fraud? Really? I mean, how is that possible? Well, I'll tell you how it's possible. It's called groupthink. Everybody gets in a room, and everybody starts agreeing with each other. And everybody's like, yeah, yeah, well, you know, I think he's good. Yeah, 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 I think he's good. And we're all trying to fit in and be part of our tribe, and we all agree. Groupthink is incredibly dangerous. Because what happens is people miss all these important things. So, it's not just about working with people different than you because it makes life better when we're civil to each other. It's that problem solving is more effective when you're working with people that you don't always agree with. Because people you don't always agree with, people who are different than you, they challenge you, they challenge you, they challenge you. A psychologist, your professors, they'll all tell you, the only time we learn something is when somebody challenges us. And usually we get challenged by a new idea, and usually that new idea comes from someone who may not think or look just like us. So do it because there are problems to be solved. Gather people together who are different, because gathering them together is going to yield a better result, because you don't all think alike. But what you have to keep in mind every step of the way is, what's most important is this problem that we all agreed we want to solve. And we're going to figure out a way to use the best of all the things we think and all the people we are to solve that problem.
Thank you, Carly, for that. Such a great reminder of a couple things. The power of convening that we have in higher education, right? Just the power of bringing people
just
together.
Bringing people together is huge.
Yeah. And then, of course, the whole purpose of a university is to bring different ideas and perspectives together, and that is how we learn. So if it can't happen here, where is it going to happen in society? Right? We need to be that model. David, we have another question out in the audience.
I'd like to put another problem in front of you to solve, at least be curious of your opinion. What do you think it's going to take to restore faith and trust in elections in America?
Well, I'll tell you in about a year when I finish with this American Bar Association task force, because that is the problem we are coming together to try and solve, a very diverse group of people, I might add. But I think it would be helpful. This is a place where ignorance is very harmful. Most Americans don't actually understand how elections work. It's not their fault, but they don't. They don't understand who's in charge of elections. They don't understand the process by which ballots are cast, votes are counted, what do you do when a vote tally is contested. They don't understand that process. They're ignorant of that process. They haven't been educated about that process. And so what happens when someone doesn't know? This is human nature. When someone doesn't know, they never assume the best. They assume the worst. So if they don't know and they don't understand, and somebody says, oh my gosh, this terrible thing has happened, and it's someone you trust who's telling you that, maybe they're a politician, maybe they're a newscaster, maybe it's your neighbor, but somebody is telling you something terrible happened, well, guess what? You're likely to believe it. So I think my own view is we have to start. Just like I think it's important that citizens understand, who are we? Where did we come from? What's different about us as a nation? I think it's important that citizens understand, how do elections work? How do they actually work? Who's in charge of them? Most people don't understand the Electoral College. Knowledge is a first step. And then I think the same things that always rebuild trust. Transparency and accountability. Show your work. Be accountable for your work. Demonstrate that what you said happened actually happened. And of course, being able to contest elections and having a judicial system that weighs in on elections is an important part of the process as well. But as we're learning, not one everyone trusts.
I think Valeria, do you have a question up there? Okay.
Oops, sorry. Hello.
Hi.
My name is Adonis Ortiz. I'm also a democracy fellow for the Madison Center for Civic Engagement. It's an honor to meet you. My question refers to the importance of history. You talked about the construction of America, the Constitution, and how these radical ideas allowed us to be able to progress and create these things such as equity, inclusion, diversity, and freedom. So my question refers to, in a time where history is being challenged, and these terms of radical are being weaponized to describe radical left or radical right, how do we reimburse the power of history to be able to move forward and make progress in a time where history itself is being diminished?
So I think that's a wonderful question, and I will use the example of Colonial Williamsburg, where I'm privileged to serve as chair, as an example of what it takes. History is boring or irrelevant to a lot of people, but stories never are. People love to hear stories about people. And so I think part of what we need to do is tell more stories of who we are and where we came from. I will give you an example. We, at Colonial Williamsburg, we have a very long tradition. In fact, we were the innovators of historic interpretation, where someone will become a historic figure and, using the actual history of that real historical figure, will play that person, will enact, will interpret that historical figure into the present. So, of course, we have James Madison, we have Thomas Jefferson, we also have enslaved people that we know were in Williamsburg. And I watched one of these. It was an example of taking a very difficult subject and allowing people to understand it. So this was a particular vignette, I will say, with four enslaved, and they were in their place of worship and talking about their lives in historically based terms from the documents we have. And one of the enslaved began to sing Amazing Grace, a song we all love. And another one of the enslaved said, "Why are you singing that song? That song was written by an enslaver. That song was written by someone trying to expiate their sin. Why are you singing that song? We should be singing our songs from our native Africa." Now, that was a moment you could hear the audience sort of intake a breath, because now we're talking about a very difficult subject. And yet, because it was a story, because they were real people talking about their real experiences, as the vignette went on, what you saw was people settle back into their chairs and say, almost without them knowing it, "I understand better. I empathize more. I can feel more deeply what their experience must have been like." In other words, I do think that we lack empathy as well as understanding in this country. And I think a telling of all of our stories across all of the communities in our Commonwealth, which is my goal as honorary chair of Virginia 250, but I think the telling of our stories told accurately and truly can build not just more understanding of who we are, but more empathy about who the other person is. And we could do with a little more empathy and a little more understanding in our country right now.
You're here. David, is there maybe one more question you've got? Okay.
Hello, my name is Joseph. Thank you so much, Ms. Farina and President, for this engaging discussion. It's given me a lot of hope. You know, I've been very down on the country for a while, so it's been nice to hear. One thing that I'm very fearful of is sort of this escalating tension with China and kind of impending conflict potentially. And I was really interested in your kind of framing of like the sovereign citizen of the US, and curious what you think about the extension of the sovereign citizen to other citizens of the globe and what the role of the U.S. is in liberating or supporting the sovereignness of other citizens in the world, or imposing our framing onto other folks, or I don't know. There seems to be many movements in the past and periods in foreign policy where the U.S. has, you know, imposed views,
yeah.
And I guess where is that place now?
Where's the line?
Where's the line, and where's also the place of a sovereign citizen in the U.S. in that discussion?
So let me take the last part of your question first. I believe that the role of a engaged citizen, a sovereign citizen, which is what you are all here at JMU to prepare to be an engaged citizen, I think the role of an engaged citizen first and foremost is to be knowledgeable about what's going on in the world. The sad truth is that most Americans don't care about foreign policy. They don't know about foreign policy. They think it's someone else's problem. So the first responsibility, I think, is to understand what's going on. The second thing I would say is China is an entirely different system than our own, and we are not going to change the Chinese system. We cannot impose our way of life on the Chinese, nor should we try. However, we can make it very clear to the Chinese that for them to invade Taiwan would be a huge peril for them. We can stand with Ukraine and say, Russia, you don't just get to take over another sovereign country because you want to. The role, I do not believe in starting wars. I think Iraq was a mistake. We had no reason to go in. I think nation building in Afghanistan was a mistake, although I do believe we needed to respond to 9/11 and deliver a devastating blow to the Taliban. But we stayed too long and spent too much trying to impose a system that clearly did not work. However, America's role in the world matters. It matters because we are the largest and most dominant economy in the world, and we will be so for a very long time, and no, the Chinese will not overtake us. The Chinese have many strengths, and they have a hold on many precious metals throughout the world. I do not underestimate the Chinese at all. But what the Chinese are not capable of doing because of their system, not because of the intelligence of their people, because of their system, the Chinese cannot innovate. And in the long run, innovation always wins. So, the role we play in the world matters. As citizens, we can all have our points of view about it. But in my opinion, we cannot simply withdraw from the world. There is a reason, for example, that President Zelensky of Ukraine, when he came to the United States for the very first time and addressed the joint sessions of Congress, he used the Battle of Saratoga as an example. My guess is most Americans didn't know why he used it as an example. But he used it as an example because what he was saying is all the values that you were founded on, sovereignty first and foremost, we are fighting for. He used it as an example to say we are a democracy fighting for our lives against an autocracy. We cannot impose our way of life or our point of view. We can be an inspiration based on our way of life, and we can defend our own interests, and defending our interests frequently means that we have to stand up against those who are trying to weaken us and overtake our interests.
Thank you so much, Carly, for your words of wisdom and for spending this precious time with us this evening. We really appreciate it. And Emma, thank you so much for the great work that you do and for joining us tonight as well. And I think you've given us some challenges, Carly, going forward to think about identifying those problems where we can try to come together, bring different minds and perspectives together, and actually work on solving problems together and listening to one another. So thank you so much for really sharing those thoughts from so many different perspectives, the roles that you have played and that you continue to play in Virginia, in our nation, in our world. We are so grateful to you for your leadership. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Carly and thanking Carly Fiorina. And Carly, on behalf of all of us at JMU, this is a token of our appreciation for all that you do for us. Thank you. Thank you all so much for coming. It's great to see you all. Please stay tuned for future Madison Vision Series events, and have a wonderful evening, everybody.
And let's thank President Alger as well for leading this splendid university and this series. Thank you. It's always a pleasure to be with you, John. Always.
Thank you.